By this time, the V-Force had been operating for 6 years, and in that time had become an extremely efficient organization. Crews were constantly tested in training exercises. Twice a year, the code Mickey Finn would be issued, and the whole of the V-Force would disperse and stand by at 15-minute readiness. In the event of early warning radar detecting a Russian nuclear strike, V-bombers on bases from the north of Scotland to Cornwall would take off in quick succession. Vulcan and Valiant, the Victor had anti-flash screens to black out the windows and protect the crew from the intense light from exploding nuclear weapons. Climbing to a cruising altitude of 56,000 feet, the bombers would fly carefully pre-planned routes and try to evade Soviet defenses for the longest possible time. To further increase their chances of survival, electronic countermeasures equipment was installed. This worked by emitting radio interference or noise. The Soviets placed great emphasis on controlling their fighter operations rigidly from the ground. Pilots were instructed where to go, when to change height, and when to fire. So blacking out the ground radar stations was an effective defensive tactic. The ECM system would be turned on at predetermined points so that no signals were emitted, pre-warning Soviet listening posts. Once the channels were turned on, V-bombers would try to sneak through the confusion. Each Soviet early warning radar area was subdivided into fighter control sectors. Each controller would attempt to position fighters at least 5 miles behind the bomber in order for the pilot to make visual contact. The Soviets at this time used 4 VHF channels to communicate with fighter aircraft. The bombers were equipped with a jammer codenamed Green Palm, which emitted a high-pitched screech on those frequencies. In spite of these defenses, some fighters would inevitably get through. The V-bomber crews then had to rely on maneuvers to try to avoid detection. A modification to the H2S radar called Fishpole would, under certain conditions, allow the nav radar to plot an approaching fighter. Bundles of tiny strips of foil or window would be released to try to confuse the Soviet radar-guided air-to-air missiles. The fighter, projecting a radar-directing beam, had to fly virtually level with the target before it could launch missiles. Those V-bombers that survived would pass from fighter sectors into missile control zones. V-bomber crews were briefed on the location of most surface-to-air missile sites. Radar detection equipment on board the aircraft would indicate when SAM radars were scanning in their direction. By 1962, there would have been too many SAM sites to skirt around them all, so the air electronics officer would try to jam the missile radar and feed it false window targets, while the pilot conducted evasive maneuvers. The main Soviet SAM missile, known as SA-2, needed 60 seconds of unjammed data to lock onto a target. Any 15-second period of effective jamming within that minute probably would have been enough to avoid destruction. The V-bombers that successfully penetrated these defenses would by now have split up to fly towards their respective targets. At 60 miles from weapon release, navigation and bombing computers would be finally updated by the nav radar, who would now be able to see the aiming point on his screen. The coordinates would then be set, allowing the aircraft to automatically home to the correct release point. Once the target's position was entered into the computer, it would pass steering information directly into the autopilot. just before the bomb release point, bomb doors would automatically open. As the bomb fell, the bomber would have just over 1 minute to get clear. The escape maneuver employed was one devised by Vickers test pilot Brian Trubshaw. It necessitated a maximum rate turn through 180 degrees before departing on a reciprocal heading at full power. This called for a high degree of skill, as too slack a turn would be useless, as all anti-flash measures assumed that the aircraft was tail-on to the blast. After this, crews were expected to try to get home. They were even given return routes, which were every bit as detailed as the outbound legs. Had this horrific scenario ever become a reality, however, there would be little or nothing for the bomber crews to return to. In the end, if a nuclear exchange ever occurred, the whole reason for the V-Force existence would be nullified. But to form an effective deterrent, the V-Force had to be an elite unit, with aircraft at the cutting edge of technology, and highly trained men permanently prepared for action.
We didn't honestly believe that we were ever going to go to war and drop this weapon. We believed that because we trained hard and made it obvious that we were training hard, we were dedicated and we were ready to go, that in the end we wouldn't have to do it. And if we did, I mean, we had failed, and even though there is a possibility we might have survived our mission, none of us would want to think about what would happen after that, because we'd have no home to go to, no families, and really no life. So not only had we failed, but the world had failed.
To test the potency of the V-Force, bombers entered competitions and exercises. Operation Sky Shield was an exercise designed to test the American newly commissioned early warning radar and air defense system named NORAD. V-bombers equipped with the latest jamming systems were detailed for the task. Flying at 56,000 feet above SAC B-52s and B-47s, simulating an attack at medium level, the V-Force aircraft penetrated unscathed. In response to ever-improving Soviet air defenses, the RAF commissioned a standoff missile system. This would allow V-bombers to release their nuclear weapons some distance away from the target, and so reduce the likelihood of the bomber being shot down en route. Codenamed Blue Steel, development work started on the project in 1956. The contract was awarded to Avro's Weapons Research Division. The missile was to have a tail-first configuration and a 60-degree delta wing, which was selected for its stability at subsonic and supersonic speed. It was to have an all-moving foreplane about half the size of the main wing and two additional fins. Finalizing the rest of the aerodynamic design occupied much of the next 2 years, involving an extensive wind tunnel program. Meanwhile, the guidance control system was being perfected. This consisted of three parts: an inertial navigator, a flight rules computer, and an autopilot. The inertial navigation system decided upon in 1954 showed considerable forward thinking. It was the only method of guiding the missile precisely without help from the ground and without sending out radar emissions. The general principle was that the inertial navigator computed the present position of the missile, the flight rules computer determined its flight plan, and the autopilot signaled the necessary control movements to obtain the required flight path. The navigation system also contained a homing computer which analyzed information about the missile's present position and velocity. Airborne trials in Australia proved the system's accuracy, with missiles regularly landing within 100 meters of the aiming point. Blue Steel was to be powered by a Bristol Siddeley Stentor rocket engine, which would send the missile up to 70,000 feet at a speed of Mach 2.5. After a flight of 100 nautical miles, which took about 4 minutes, the missile would then dive onto the target. One of the biggest problems that had to be surmounted was marrying blue steel to the aircraft that were to carry it operationally, the Vulcan B-2 and the Victor B-2. The missile had to be compatible with both of them. The aircraft themselves were of quite different design, and both required complex modifications. The interface between missile and aircraft included warm air and refrigeration supplies and hydraulic power. Electrical monitoring and data transfer was carried out by three connectors, each with 157 contacts. Every connection had to separate cleanly on missile release. One of the problems of compatibility with the Victor was due to the limited ground clearance of the bomb bay. Blue steel missiles designed to equip Victors had a special modification in the form of a folding lower fin. The Vulcan, with its bomb bay 6 feet above the ground, had the opposite problem. Different designs of low loader were prepared to suit each aircraft type.
The blue steel missile was a liquid-fueled missile, and the two ingredients of the mixture were kerosene and high-test peroxide. Now, high-test peroxide is a very, very dangerous substance to handle. A small spot onto the skin and it burns straight through to the bone. And any mixture of this pure high-test peroxide with any contaminant, and it could cause a fire or an explosion. If we landed away from our home base, we had to monitor every hour the temperature of this particular, of the high-test peroxide particularly. And if this started to rise because it got a small amount of contamination in it, then we had a very short time to unload this into a ditch or a prepared area, which we would only land at bases with a fuel missile where they had a prepared area. But it took literally millions of gallons of water to be mixed with this, to disperse it, to stop it being dangerous as you unloaded it. And you had to be dressed head to foot in protective PVC clothing, and it was not a procedure that we liked at all.
Handley Page equipped new Victors designed to take the missile with more powerful Rolls-Royce Conway Co-17 engines and a combustor igniter system. This would start all four engines simultaneously and reduce scramble time to an average of 1.5 minutes per aircraft. Of the 30 Victor B-2s built, 23 were converted to carry the standoff weapon, with the first being delivered to the RAF in July 1963. Handley Page's tender submission was accepted. The design of the HP-80 prototype had been virtually finalized in the Cricklewood Drawing Office. A number of changes were made to the design during that year, including moving the tailplane to the top of the fin. The T-tail configuration was every bit as novel as the crescent-shaped wing, so both theories would require extensive testing. The Ministry of Supply authorized the building of a 1/3 scale manned research aircraft to test HP-80's aerodynamic characteristics. Designated HP-88, the aircraft flew for the first time on the 21st of June, 1951. Meanwhile, the first full-size prototype was at an advanced stage of construction. Handley Page had entertained hopes that the first prototype would be flown in time to be displayed publicly at Farnborough in September 1952. During the preparation for the maiden flight, however, a number of technical setbacks beset the Victor project. To complicate matters still further, the Ministry of Supply deemed the company's airfield at Radlett to be too small to allow an adequate safety margin. This meant the prototype had to be dismantled and transported by road to Boscombe Down. This operation was conducted in the utmost secrecy. Handley Page went to extraordinary lengths to ensure the bomber was shielded from view. A framework was built on the transporter, which was then covered with a white tarpaulin. The idea was to make it look like the hull of a boat. It was soon clear that the prototype would not be ready for the Farnborough air display. In fact, it was not until the Christmas Eve of 1952 that HP-80 made its maiden flight.
As the Handipig Victor takes the air, we see a new shape rise in the sky. At all speeds near the ground, the crescent-winged aircraft controls easily enough to please the most exacting pilot. While at takeoff and landing, the attitude is normal enough to reassure the most conventional. These are important factors when pilot familiarization is considered. No small crescent-winged trainers are needed. Notice the dive brakes, which on the Victor control the glide path without any change of trim. Victor comes to land, and one of its most important features comes into play. With hands off the controls, the pilot brings it in on the approach. It flattens out and lands without the pilot touching the controls. An amazing and almost unbelievable characteristic of this crescent-winged aircraft.
In most aircraft, just before touchdown, the ground cancels out the downwash effect of the tailplane. The pilot has to make compensating control movements to counteract this. The Victor's high-set tailplane, however, eliminated this effect almost entirely. The aircraft's structure was just as unique. The wings were of a sandwich construction with a corrugated aluminium core, giving them considerable strength for their weight. Control surfaces operated through electrically actuated hydraulically powered control units. Engines were buried in the wing roots in engine compartments large enough to accommodate the more powerful power plants envisaged for later marks. Handley Page also employed revolutionary spot welding techniques to attach the outer skin to the core of the wing. As for the Valiant and the Vulcan, the Victor was to have a crew of five, but unlike the layout of the other two V-bombers, the rear crew and pilots were not on markedly different levels. The crescent-shaped wing joined the fuselage well forward, allowing the weapons bay to be completely unobstructed. This took up most of the fuselage and was almost twice the size of that of the Vulcan. As an alternative to the projected 10,000-pound nuclear store, it could carry 35 1,000-pound bombs, as opposed to the Vulcan's 21. The prototype flight test program proceeded on schedule. High-altitude maneuvering trials in 1954 revealed good handling characteristics in steep turns at speeds of up to Mach 0.85. On the 14th of July, the prototype was involved in a series of high-speed, low-level runs over Cranfield Aerodrome. During one of these, disaster struck. The tail assembly started to flutter, and seconds later, the tailplane broke away, causing the aircraft to dive into the ground. The crew were killed in the crash. The cause was later attributed to fatigue failure of three bolts which joined the tailplane to the fin. The joint and tail were stiffened on the second prototype, WB-775, and the first 25 production aircraft, which were now under construction, were fitted with a fourth bolt. The first of these flew in February 1956. The following year, the Victor became the largest aircraft in the world to break the sound barrier. Like the Avro Vulcan, the Victor was found to be capable of performance and aerobatics that belied its size. At Farnborough, it performed slow rolls, loops and rolls off the top. Avro and Handley Page always thought there would be a fly-off between the Vulcan and the Victor. This led to intense competition between the two companies. Both aeronautical firms could ill afford to lose the production contracts.
When the two companies were getting their heads together, they were both facing similar problems, and they decided to have a meeting at Cricklewood, the home of Handy Page, to talk about common problems. When the meeting had started, there was a phone call, and the senior Avro man was called out, and he came back and said that one of his bosses, Sir Roy Dobson, was on the telephone and would not allow the meeting to continue, and they were not to talk to Handy Page, and they were to come back north as soon as possible.
In terms of performance, both aircraft met the required specifications. The Victor had a longer range and higher ceiling because of its better maximum lift coefficient and lower drag. The Vulcan, on the other hand, had manifestly superior maneuverability and takeoff performance.
The Victor 1 was always fitted with Sapphire 7 engines. The developed engine, the Sapphire 9, was cancelled. It was designed mainly for a fighter engine, and was cancelled, leaving the Victor always with just 11,000 pounds of thrust. The Vulcan was powered by Olympus engines, which were developed continually and always had more thrust available.
The balance between the Victor and Vulcan is illustrated clearly by the Ministry of Supply's inability to choose between them. In the end, 86 Victors and 138 Vulcans were constructed. The major design improvement to the Victor B2 concerned the installation of a new power plant, the Rolls-Royce Conway engine, which produced 17,250 pounds of static thrust. The new engine would increase the ceiling altitude of the Victor, improving its chances of survival in a hostile SAM environment. The B-2 also had a greater range, making it a more suitable platform for Blue Steel. The prototype B-2 flew for the first time on the 20th of February, 1959. On the 20th of August that year, this aircraft failed to return. The loss of this Victor and its crew heightened the debate on the safety features of V-Force aircraft.
During the original design of the Victor, there is a story that goes that the original plan was to have the whole front of the aircraft from the pressure bulkhead forward make it jettisonable from the rest of the aircraft so that if there was a problem, the entire cockpit would separate from the aircraft. But apparently during testing of this system on a model, the static line between the fuselage and the cockpit was made too short so that when they ran the test, the parachute deployed too soon, with the result that a successful jettison wouldn't have been possible. Because of this, ejection seats were installed at the front and the rear crew had to jump through the crew escape door.
In February 1962, the 1st Victor B-2 Squadron, number 139, formed at RAF Wittering. It was re-equipped with Blue Steel the following year. During this period, Soviet air defense systems were improving rapidly. By 1963, British strategists no longer believed that high altitude would offer any protection to a V-bomber. The Soviet missiles were arranged to provide overlapping cover at height. At low level, however, there were large gaps in the radar screen. Tests with Blue Steel proved that the missile was just as effective released at low level as it was from high altitude. That year, the decision was made. Victors and Vulcans, repainted in green and grey camouflage, began low-level training.
The strike force then had one purpose, that was deterrence, to make it known that we'd go to war if that was required. And to that end, we trained in our particular role with the Blue Steel missile, that was to fly low level, 250 feet, to get under the enemy radar and to fly across terrain that was as rough and as near to what we could expect to get when we approached the target. Therefore, a lot of our training, of course, was done in Canada, across the northern part of Canada, out of Goose Bay, Labrador, and across the snowy wastes.
For the aging Vickers Valiant, however, the stresses imposed by low-level flying would prove too much. During 1964, fatigue fractures were found in the rear spar of one aircraft. Inspections on the rest of the fleet revealed similar problems. the 6th Valiant Squadron, still serving with the RAF, were withdrawn at the end of that year. Together with the Bomber Squadron, the Valiant Tanker Force were also prematurely retired. Their sudden demise left the RAF dangerously exposed without air-to-air refueling facilities. To fill the gap, the victors of 55 Squadron relinquished their bombing role in March of 1965 and were fully operational tankers by June. All through that year, the Handley Page Works at Rabbit proceeded with further tanker conversion work. Another role vacated by the Valiant was that of reconnaissance. The Victor SR-2 was introduced in 1966 to fulfill this need.
The Victor was particularly well equipped for that. If I can give you an example, to do a shipping count in the Mediterranean, that's not identifying ships, that's on radar, locating every ship that's out in the Mediterranean. One Victor can do the whole Mediterranean in a 7 to 8 hour flight. There is no other system at the time, until the satellites started coming along, that could do that. And then, knowing the position of the fishing fleet, etc., we would work in conjunction with maritime aircraft, Nimrods and Shackletons. And if they were looking for a particular set of ships or ship, they knew from our general plot which ones they could eliminate and where to go to make a positive identification of whatever shipping they were looking at. So the Victor, with its high level, I mean, it did that sort of run at 45,000 feet. It had the range to go from the UK to do the whole of the Mediterranean and then land in Cyprus in the one mission. No other aircraft could have done that at the time.
The Victor gave up its strategic deterrent role in 1968 as the Navy's Polaris submarines came into service. Refueling operations with the converted Victor B-1 aircraft had revealed the requirement for converting the B-2 variant. Its longer range, increased power and greater fuel capacity would allow tanking to be carried out from airfields at high altitudes and in hot climates. It was originally planned that Victor K-2, as it would be known, would enter service in 1973. The collapse of the Handley Page Company in 1970 delayed the conversion. Ironically, the work was carried out at the former Vulcan factories at Chadderton and Woodford, near Manchester. The primary role of the Victor was in support of fighter aircraft for the interception of intruders into UK airspace. The Lightning, for example, though a potent fighter, had a very limited range and relied heavily on air-to-air refueling to be effective. In April 1982, Argentina invaded the Falkland Islands. The nearest operating base available to the RAF was Wide Awake Airfield on the island of Ascension, 3,375 miles away from the Falklands. Victor tankers were needed to bridge the gap. Aircraft from 55 and 57 squadrons, as well as 232 Operation Conversion Unit, were tasked to support the British task force. Victors were also converted for maritime radar reconnaissance. Cameras were installed and improvements were made to the radar and long-range navigation systems. By the 29th of April, almost the entire Victor fleet was based on Ascension. The first task involved four Victors patrolling an area to the north of South Georgia. The information gained during one sortie, which took over 14 hours, helped make possible the retaking of the island by British troops. On the 1st of May 1982, the RAF mounted the longest bombing raid in history. The mission, to bomb Port Stanley Airfield 8 hours flying time away, was logistically extremely problematic. It would involve a Vulcan bomber and 11 supporting Victor tankers. All refueling rendezvous would have to take place at night, and 18 would be needed to refuel the Vulcan and the Victor tankers themselves. There were five Black Buck missions in total, with 500,000 pounds of fuel being transferred in each.
At night and heavy rain, this is the single panel that we've got available to us to actually see the runway on the approach, because the rest of the panels will be covered in rain. And this means that visibility can be fairly limited on such an approach. Beyond that, during the daytime, as you can see here, all these window arches tend to get in the way of our visibility looking out of the front window. And if you actually want to try and spot traffic, you have to move your head around to be able to look beyond the various arches which get in your line of sight. The reason for this design is mainly because the Victor was originally designed as a high altitude bomber, and it was believed that the nuclear flash would be a major problem, so that these panels up here were originally fully enclosed, and it was only later that they elected to put glass into this top panel, and they then added these blind system, which is actually zipped down prior to delivering a nuclear attack. On the Victor, we have a control column, unlike on the Vulcan, where there's a flight stick. The stick tends to imply more fighter-like handling qualities, whereas the column on the Victor implies more truck-like handling, which, if you talk to any of both the Victor and Vulcan pilots, those who have flown both aircraft, will tend to agree with that. On the yoke, we have the intercom switch, and on the other side of that position, the push to talk for the radio. On the top, an autopilot cutout, and then moving around to the other side, the pitch trim switch. Around the back of the stick, there's an instinctive cutout for the autopilot master switches. And then when the aircraft was a bomber, this position here would have had the commit button for the bombing system. Okay, down on this corner of the flight instrument panel, we've got the map meter, which, as you can see, is only starts to indicate at about 0.6 Mach. And beyond that, it travels up to a normal operating limit of 0.9 on the Victor. So for operational reasons, we can go up to 0.95 Mach. And when this aircraft was first going through development as a bomber, and it was a lot cleaner than it is now, one of these aircraft, in fact, several aircraft, were taken through the speed of sound. The main flying instruments when in cloud for the Victor are the artificial horizon here and the beam compass. This will give us pitch, roll and indications, and the attitude direction pointer here will give us a left-right steering command. Either when we're flying on an ILS, the instrument landing system, or when used in conjunction with the beam compass, it will give us a heading to steer towards. So if we're presently heading 215, if we wanted to maintain that heading, we've got that there, but if we wanted to come right onto 214, it gives us the steer right indication. This is actually very good for making an instrument landing system approach. Essentially an artificial Horizon and Compass, which is both elements of the military flight system, which is also used in the Vulcan. The engines are started by compressed air using the equivalent of a turbocharger at the base of the engine. This turbine is spun up, and through the gearbox it winds up the inner spool of the engine. This then draws air through the outer spool, and once a certain RPM is achieved, we open the high pressure fuel cocks to introduce fuel to the engine. The spark is already going as part of the start cycle, and then the flames ignite in the combustion chamber, and the engines accelerate up to a self-sustaining speed of about 38%, and then wind up to the idle speed of about 46 to 49% RPM. The normal start cycle takes 30 seconds using compressed air from the auxiliary airborne power plant, which is a small gas turbine down in the right-hand wing route, from a ground-based STAD or PLU system, which is essentially a compressed air source outside of the aircraft, and then the combustor start, which is a throwback to the days when the aircraft was a bomber. We could achieve a rapid start by selecting combustor, selecting all of the switches on with the ignition on, and by pressing this button, and with the high pressure fuel cocks already open, the engines could start within 15 seconds.
1990, victims from 55 Squadron, the last to fly the former V-bomber, were tasked with the deployment of forces to the Gulf. In December, after ground training was complete, victors supporting Jaguar and Tornadoes began flying. It became apparent that the initial plan to limit the victor support to the RAF was impractical. Eventually, victors refueled all types of aircraft from the UK, US Navy and Air Force, as well as Canada and France. Sorties were flown into the heart of hostile territory. To ensure that all contingencies were met and that fuel was available for aircraft returning from missions, all victors carried maximum fuel loads. 290 sorties were flown over the 42-day war, an average of 33 missions per crew. In spite of very poor weather and maximum takeoff waste eroding the aircraft's fatigue life, the victors successfully completed every single sortie they were tasked to do. The 55 Squadron continued to operate from Akrotiri until February 1992, when this role was taken over by 101 Squadron VC-10s.
orbital loss of
K2 8 miles per land.
The last Victor returned from the Gulf in September 1993 in preparation for the squadron's official disbandment. 55 Squadron holds the record for flying a single aircraft type for the longest period, from the Victor B-1 in September 1960 to the Victor K-2 in October 1993. 40 years after the prototype took to the air, the fatigue life on the seven remaining victors has finally expired. This type's demise marks the end of a generation of British aircraft that set new standards in design, aerodynamics, and manufacture. Sadly, the Victor's decommissioning also represents the end of any flying reminder of the V-Force.